It's the voice of St. Louis, KMOX. My name is Bo Matthews. It is Super Bowl Sunday, but before we get to all that hoopla going on this afternoon, we are going to have our show. We go till 3, and of course, we encourage you to download the radio.com app to your device, whether it's your iPad or your phone. You can connect it to Alexa. Of course, you can connect it to your phone, into your car, which makes it so easy. Just go to the App Store or the Google Play Store and download radio.com. That's a name of the app. It's a big blue R, and then you'll have so much great content to include. And not that I'm calling this great content, but this interview is going to be great content because I have found a new appreciation for not only the history of our country, but the history of St. Louis. We've got John Launius. He is the president of Vidzu Media, part of the Nitrous Effect, and is the author of The Life and Times of Missouri's Charles Parsons, Between Art and War. And John, you and I actually met on LinkedIn, which who knew you'd be in my studio now, but welcome to KMOX.
Thank you, Bo. It's really great to be here. I want you to know that my wife has been a huge fan of yours for a very long time.
Oh, man. Thank you very much.
So she said, when you see Bo on Sunday, you tell him that. And I'm just
tear in my eye. That's awesome. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
You know, and really, I don't know how long you have to live in St. Louis to be considered from St. Louis. Although when I go on vacation, people say, where are you from? I'm from St. Louis.
Yeah.
I grew up as an Air Force brat, so all over, but I've been here since 88. So nice. Just in the last several years, though, I've really found that the deep history of this town is so important. And when I found out about your book, that almost didn't happen, as I just heard, it really intrigued me because I'm also married to an artist, so we love the art museum. You have a connection, Charles Parsons has a connection in this as well. Let's begin with, where did the passion come for this book? Because out of the blue, who would write about a guy named Chucky?
Yeah, I love it. So Charles Parsons was one of the people who was on the board of control for the first art museum west of the Mississippi. So it was the St. Louis Museum and School of Fine Arts at 19th and Locust, which is now just a big warehouse.
And what era? 1800?
So you're talking 1883, essentially,
okay,
is when it opened. So in 2006, when I started working at Washington University in St. Louis, I had come from a five-year journey as an intelligence and security contractor for the U.S. Department of Homeland Security and other agencies. And one of the first things that we did when I got to WashU, my accountability was to work with security and training and open the Mildred Lane Kemper Art Museum at Washington University in St. Louis.
Okay.
And in 1905, when Charles Parsons passed away, he bequeathed his entire collection of art and artifacts to Washington University. So I'm sure you've seen the mummies at the St. Louis Art Museum.
Absolutely. Several times.
Yeah. So in 1896, he purchased those for Washington University for display and for study, but because of security reasons, which we may get to in this interview, it's in the book, but they're actually held in perpetuity at the St. Louis Art Museum instead of WashU. But to answer your question, one of the first things that we did was we pulled out the collection of Charles Parsons. Sabina Ekman, who's the director of the museum there, wanted to see the collection to see if she wanted to include that in future exhibitions.
So it was locked up somewhere.
It was locked up. I mean, the pieces have been on display, you know, since 1905 here and there. But we're talking 300 paintings. We're talking 800 objects. Like just the actually at the time when he was living, it was actually considered one of the finest art collections in the entire country.
Wow.
And so on the table, though, there were a bunch of objects, and one of them was an incense burner, actually specifically a Japanese incense burner that was mislabeled as a bowl. Now, I've studied Japanese incense and traditions since I was 9 years old, so I immediately saw the iconography and saw the piece, and I'm like, that's not a bowl. And so I talked to Sabina, and she said, what is it? And I said, it's a Tokugawa incense burner, and she said, write an essay. So in that moment in 2006-07, suddenly I'm researching this man, and all of a sudden it opens up into Civil War. It opens up into the fact that St. Louis Children's Hospital used to be called the Martha Parsons Free Hospital for Children.
For his wife?
For his wife.
What?
That when he endowed it. So you suddenly see somebody who is making great contributions to St. Louis in the 19th century, but because he invested in art and didn't put his name on a building, That's why you don't know him today.
Well, your YouTube channel, I don't know if we want to put that out there, but the videos are on that are on it are just one-minute segments, and I got to listen to those before this was happening, and it was amazing how you touched in through the book on his history. And whenever I hear of that era, 1800s, early 1900s, that they traveled around the world, it's like, I don't want to travel, and we've got planes, internationally anyway. But you mentioned the Japanese incense burner.
Yeah.
I read somewhere on your bio that you are a martial arts specialist?
Yeah, so I've trained in martial arts since I was 9 years old.
Okay.
I'm a third-degree black belt. I've trained in Taekwondo, Shotokan, Judo, Yagushin Kageru, and then Aikido for the past 26 years.
So the reason I bring that up is because when you get focused on something, you go all in, as you did with Mr. Parsons.
Yeah.
And so in 07, 06, 07 is when you the aha moment happened.
Yeah.
That this guy, nobody knows anything about this guy.
Mm-hmm.
So you start digging.
Yeah, so I started digging. And, you know, what I was telling your producer but before we went on the air, what's interesting is that I really want to thank Google. And I know a lot of people don't want to thank Google, but I want to, because in around 2005, 2006, Google said, we're going to find every historical archive on the planet. And we're going to digitize, and we're going to give you the ability to search keywords. And out of that, what happened was I suddenly was able to see just so many newspaper articles, so many historical documents that suddenly I said, oh, my gosh, really the life and times of Missouri's Charles Parsons, who, yes, he was from New York, but he came originally to St. Louis in 1851, went to Keokuk, Iowa, experienced one of the first economic crashes in the country that actually would actually move us closer to the Civil War, came back to St. Louis, but then said, St. Louis is where I'm going to hang my hat. During the Civil War, he moved General Sherman's and General Grant's armies. He got acknowledged by them. He became best friends with General Sherman when Sherman was literally living about 10 blocks from the studio right now,
right,
and only about 6 blocks from where Charles Parsons lived. And so suddenly you start to piece this together, and it really was a process of 9 years of research and then 1 year of writing to put together a 65,000-word book, 125 sources, 610 citations.
Right.
But it's not boring.
No, I found the videos very fascinating. The book had not arrived yet, by the way.
Okay.
But when I get it, I for some reason in the last decade, I've really started to read. But the connections of Charles Parsons and the art museum, talk about that part, that when you discovered this part of it, It shows that in the Civil War era, he wasn't collecting art at that time, was he?
No, he was not. No,
he was doing, what was he doing?
So during the Civil War, he was the general quartermaster in the city of St. Louis. There were 4 quartermasters, and he was actually under the command of his brother, who was Lewis B. Parsons, who had been to Yale and Harvard and was best friends with President Lincoln. And so basically working under his brother, his job was to move all of the armies in the Western Theater from St. Louis. So in that, though, he learned all about rail and river transportation,
sure.
which would then start to build his fortunes after the Civil War. So sometime around 1868, 69, he starts to collect art. There's a woman by the name of Harriet Hosmer, who was the first female world sculptor to achieve international acclaim on her own. But she was trained in St. Louis at what was originally Washington University School of Medicine. It was called something before that. But in supporting all these artists in St. Louis in the 19th century, when we were the fourth city,
right,
you know, you started to see a development of not only business and art, but really put into motion contributions to the community that still can be seen today.
So when he was a quartermaster, his job was moving these groups of people around, groups of soldiers around. Mm-hmm. What was his path to get out of that and get on to meeting his wife and getting what was that transition? What did you find out from Google?
Yeah. Well, so from Google, you could start to see a lot of the letters that took place. So in 1864, Charles Parsons resigns his commission and enters back into banking. So he had been a banker in Keokuk, Iowa,
right,
during one of the crashes, but started as the cashier of the State Bank of St. Louis, which may not sound like a an exotic title, but the cashier was the one responsible for really everything. So after that, though, he would get promoted to president and would start to use banking as a way to cause the common good, as he would call it. If you know much about finance, there's the whole balance or the whole fight between the silver standard and the gold standard.
Right.
So he actually fought for us to stay on the gold standard when the silver standard was beginning to be it was called free silver, which was the argument. So looking at all of these little pieces of information that sometimes could only be a paragraph long, you know, through Google and through other historical, you know, archives like the Missouri Historical Society, which I'm so grateful for, and it's a wonderful resource here in St. Louis, you're able to begin to put a story together that anyone can approach in our modern time.
John Launius is president of Vidzu Media and the author of The Life and Times of Missouri's Charles Parsons, Between Art and War, which comes out
February 17th.
Oh, it's coming quick.
Yeah.
You excited?
I am.
I want to hang on to you, and I want you to stick around, because there is so much more, especially when it comes to how important artwork is. As I mentioned, I'm married to an artist, and there are many of her paintings that are documenting the times that we're living through. Mm-hmm. And I believe that's what an artist does, whether it's a songwriter, an author, a painter, a digital artist, if you will, they document these times. And I think it's very intriguing, especially when school systems don't have a big emphasis on creative and on art. That's a whole nother show, but it's nice to know that that we do have the great art museum and Washington University and all the collections that we have here in St. Louis. So John Launius, sticking around. He's coming up more with his story and actually Charles Parsons' story next on The Voice of St. Louis, KMOX. It's The Voice of St. Louis, KMOX. My name is Bo Matthews, and we've got a very special guest here that ironically works in the same building as our studio, Vidzu Media. I've been seeing your parking signs everywhere. John Launius is the president of Vidzu Media, part of Nitrous Effect, and you do all kinds of projects, but this passion project of yours as the author of The Life and Times of Missouri's Charles Parsons, Between Art and War, was actually spawned by somebody saying you should write a paper, one paper on this, and this turned into so much research, just like our conversation here. There's just so much to go into when it comes to something so fantastic about St. Louis.
Yep.
Charles Parsons, a strong Christian. Tell me the Christian connection that he has to the facilities here.
So Charles Parsons, actually, his father, when they were being raised in New York, actually at the age of 11, Charles Parsons had to sign the Bible promising that he would never drink a drop of alcohol.
Wow.
And it was really all about that. Charles Parsons' father, who was Lewis Parsons Sr., basically said, you know, everything in your life should be in the service of the Lord and should really be about the common good. So his father passes away in the 1850s, and his father said, I want to create a Christian college, and I want to create it in Iowa, because at that time, Charles Parsons was living in Keokuk, Iowa. He was running a bank, and his father had come and visited him and basically said, I'm going to go out and look into the wilderness. And he had this vision that Iowa would be a place that would grow over time, and that's where he would build his Christian college. Well, it didn't actually happen until 1875, because the Civil War got in the way of that. And what happened was that Charles Parsons, along with a number of other ministers, they built Parsons College, which was around from 1875 to 1975. And what's interesting is that in 1975, a guy by the name of Maharishi bought it, i.e. the guy that was teaching the Beatles how to meditate. And so so you can still visit Parsons College, but it's a little bit different now.
That is crazy. Yeah. The connections are amazing. And we're talking about the 1800s, early 1900s. We had a guest a few weeks ago from Fort Deschardes. He was the caretaker of that down in Prairie du Rocher. Mm-hmm. That was 150 years before what we're talking about. Yep. Wasn't there talk that Keokuk, Iowa, was going to be a bigger stop than St. Louis?
Yep.
At the time you're talking about.
Yeah, so Keokuk was a boom town of the 19th century. If you think about it on a map, it's actually, if you're coming from the north to the south, you're going to run into Keokuk before you run into St. Louis.
Sure, of course.
And so at that time, there was a fight going on in St. Louis about the ferry system going across the river. They didn't want to build a bridge. The railroads were like, okay, well, if we can't build a bridge, we're just going to go ahead and go north. So Keokuk built a bridge. So therefore, suddenly you've got train traffic moving. So suddenly overnight, you know, you've got Keokuk growing at just this massive rate. People like Samuel Clemens, i.e. Mark Twain, was working in Keokuk at that time. You had people that we still know today were working and living in Keokuk, and Charles Parsons was one of them.
So moving to Charles Parsons' life in St. Louis and his collection of his art and where that all ended up, and where he met his wife. Did he meet her here?
So he met his wife here in St. Louis. So you talk about connections. So Missouri celebrates its 200th anniversary in 2021, because in 1821, it was written into the Union, Charles Parsons' wife's father, William Grimes Pettis, was the man who wrote Missouri into the Union in 1821.
Wow.
He was best friends with Wayman Crow. Who's Wayman Crow? Wayman Crow was a senator who actually then created the first art museum west of the Mississippi by endowing it. And so Charles marries into essentially the St. Louis elite and begins to work in circles where, say, they realize that, in the sense of really causing St. Louis to become the gate city or the gateway city, Keokuk had used the word gate city at one point, but in looking at being a gateway to the West, they said, what's one thing that we can do to really start to build us up as a cultural center? And that was to bring art to St. Louis.
Right, and it did.
So Wayman Crow's son had passed away about a year before he had cracked the idea of starting the first art museum west of the Mississippi. So suddenly you've got art that's coming in from France, from England, from American artists, and it's available for all people. So the St. Louis Art Museum says free to all. And so, but that idea was started with the first art museum west of the Mississippi a good 30 years before St. Louis Art Museum was even an idea.
I would like to interject here that anytime I see Timmy Zell on Channel 2 sledding down Art Hill or whatever, again, my wife loves going to the art museum. It's a beautiful hill. It's great for sledding, but it's like, I wonder how many percentage of the people that sled on Art Hill have actually walked through the doors of that magnificent facility.
Yeah.
And if you haven't, I challenge you to do it, because it is amazing. They have rotating shows that come through and stuff. But like the mummies that you mentioned Charles Parsons acquiring from Egypt, they're still there and on display.
Yeah, and actually one of them, Henneth Wedjabu, Henneth Wedjabu.
Okay.
Henneth Wedjabu is actually one of the most rare mummies outside of Egypt, and it's right here in St. Louis.
Oh.
So Petmenech and Henneth Wedjabu were the two mummies Charles Parsons bought in 1896 from Emil Bruschke. If you know anything about Egyptian history, Emil Bruschke is one of those people. He's pretty notorious because, you know, at that time, archaeology was pretty much, okay, let's just go ahead and pull everything out and dig it.
Right.
And not necessarily document everything.
Or take care of it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so what Charles was committed to was to have, you know, these Egyptian mummies for Washington University in St. Louis for study, but also for public view. And that's the distinction, because in the 19th century, people who had art collections had money and, for the most part, didn't want everybody to come look at it. Now, there were some people who, you know, the exact quote was, if you are of good repute, you can bring this past to my house and look at my art.
Right.
But the distinction of making it available to everybody is one of the ways that Charles Parsons and his circle of friends look to develop St. Louis as a cultural center.
We're talking with John Launius. He's president of Vidzu Media, but author of The Life and Times of Missouri's Charles Parsons, Between Art and War. You mentioned your wife in the last segment.
Yeah.
Is she as up to speed on Charles Parsons as you are, and she tired of hearing about it, or what's the story?
Well,
I want to
know. It's one of those things where I'm so grateful to her because she's listened to me tell these stories for a decade. You know, the dedication of the book says, to my grandfather, Harry Sparks, and to my wife, Amy. One provided the perfect model of the Renaissance man to follow, and the other the perfect partner to dance through the ages, totally and completely, forever and always.
Wow, beautiful.
And so, you know, in that way, there's a whole, sometimes when you read a book, you don't really read the acknowledgments. And I invite everyone to do that, because the Mildred Lane Kemper Art Museum at Washington University in St. Louis, I'm so grateful to them for access to the collection and their support, the Missouri Historical Society. I mean, I could give you a list, St. Louis Art Museum, and the images that they gave me. There's 30 images in this book. Some of them have never been seen before.
Oh, my goodness.
And so just the amount of support that I received from St. Louis for this book about a man who very few people know about has been pretty incredible.
It is. And again, your YouTube channel, people can find you at?
So the YouTube channel, just look up Charles Parsons, and there's about 20 videos that are there. And just a little bit of background on that. Each video, Bo, as you said, is 1 minute long.
Yeah.
I took 11 pages of the 176-page book and gave people a taste. So it's 20 minutes, but it only accounts for 11 pages of the book.
It really is amazing. And I again, I'm a reader, but people can follow you about the book on all the social medias. Parsons Book is basically what you look up. The website is parsonsbook.com. Can you purchase it through there?
You cannot purchase it through there, but there is a link.
Okay.
It's available everywhere, and here's what I would say. I'm a real big fan of supporting local, so if you've got a favorite bookstore, you know, just talk to them and get the book. Yes, you can get it on Amazon.
Sure.
Yes, you can get it on my publisher's website, which my publisher, I'm super excited by, the History Press and Arcadia Press, so supportive. They've put together a beautiful book. I mean, you just looked at it.
Yeah, you said hold this, and so I held the book, and why does it seem like it's 10 pounds? Because there's so much information in there.
Yeah, well, I mean, so what they did was that they used archival paper. And instead of just newsprint.
Yeah.
And so it's a beautiful book. And that's what I'm excited by, because if you're going to spend 10 years writing something, hopefully it's beautiful, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So,
You know, Charles Parsons, his love of art has impacted St. Louis. And those that are of culture can go. No, I'm kidding. the great thing about it, though, is that his love of art has transcended through to you and to anybody else that has gone and has been able to see it. It does crush me every time I see, like, when Baghdad fell and they were crushing the statues and the artwork. I'm like, this is the history of the world, people.
Yeah.
We are here for a moment. What are you doing? And so it's neat to see that so many things have been preserved by Charles Parsons. You have a live event coming up, or you have a few coming up you want to mention real quick?
Yeah, so February 26th, they're going to be at Subterranean Books from 7 to 9. This is the first actual book launch and signing. I'll speak a little bit about Charles Parsons, and then we'll get into that. Before I tell you about the other events, I just want to circle back to what you said about seeing the art in Baghdad. What I love about the story of Charles Parsons is right now, you can go to the permanent collection at the Mildred Lane Kemper Art Museum at WashU and literally see the works that he collected from Corot, Church, Gifford, and Innes. Amazing American and European painters. And you can see it right now.
Wow.
March 14th, we're going to be at the Bellefontaine Cemetery at the Hotchkiss Chapel from 2 to 4. There, I'm going to be giving a demonstration on Japanese incense. So people think they know incense, but no, not at all. This is really the real historical Japanese incense. I'll be speaking on that.
Okay.
And then March 21st, actually, we're going to be in this building on the ground floor at Art St. Louis from 1 to 3. I'll give a talk on actually 19th century art collection of Charles Parsons.
Fantastic. John Launius, president of Vidzu Media, author of The Life and Times of Missouri's Charles Parsons, Between Art and War. What a great passion project you've had. And so glad that you came and spoke to us here today. Hope to see you on February 26th, and I wish you a ton of luck on this. When is the book out again?
So the book officially comes out February 17th, and I just want to thank you, Bo. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk about Charles Parsons.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
The Life and Times of Missouri's Charles Parsons, Between Art and War, details the life of one of St. Louis's and the nation's most influential, yet little-known figures. As a U.S. Civil War quartermaster and advisor to generals, politicians, and presidents alike, he was instrumental to the Union cause. As a world-traveling art connoisseur, he helped found the first art museum west of the Mississippi and donated his remarkable collection of American and European paintings and Japanese and Chinese art. And to this day, his philanthropic work and dedication to education live on in some of the country's grandest institutions. From his business failures in a Riverside boomtown to his rise to national renown, this book tells his full story for the first time, with the attention and spirit the subject is due.